there comes a point in your life where it's like, I'm not suicidal, but I'm tired of living. And I needed a reason to live. I really did have ideas of quitting Albright and doing mercenary work. Because at least at that point in time, I could feel alive. I could be where everything made sense. I thought I wanted to be a Navy SEAL because my dad said that they were badasses. I ended up joining the Air Force as a vehicle operator, thinking I wasn't going to get deployed. Or if I did get deployed, it'd be fun. But the first day I had to go outside the wire. I remember looking around Iraq, thinking the entire world wants to kill you. And the second deployment was a lot worse than the first one. We had a lot more ambushes. This vehicle got really close to us, and when it's a not-friendly vehicle, you assume a vehicle-borne explosive device. I remember the wind going, the rain, the glow of the speedometer and everything. I was like, so this is it. This is the moment before I die. When asked to re-enlist, I was like, I can't do it. I wanted more out of life. And then I started learning things on my third deployment, like how to play the piano. I started reading books. I learned how to solve the Rubik's Cube. I had this wonderful girlfriend, and she told me, go to college. You don't belong in the military. You have a lot more to offer. But then when I got out, I really didn't care about much of anything. Nothing got my blood going. Nothing. There was no hope. I spent a lot of nights staring at a fire, wishing I could be back in Iraq so bad. I guess what stopped me from reenlisting was blind hope that I was doing the right thing, and I had to listen to my parents. My mom and my dad told me, you need to stay out. I remember my brother always talked about acting, so that had always been in the back of my mind, like, I'll go to acting school. The fall semester came up, and I remember I said, you know what? I never tried acting. I was like, I can't do acting because I'm not going to get a job. I'm going to be poor. I'm going to be wasting my GI Bill. But then, yeah, I was like, you know what? Just try it. I remember the first day going to acting class. It was a new acting teacher. He made us do this exercise where we had to sit across from somebody, and he gave us a line. And my line was, I want you to take care of me. And the other girl's line was, I want you to go away. So I'm sweating bullets, and I'm the last person to go. And I was ready to walk out of the class. But I sat down in the seat. My heart was pounding. I was scared. And action. And I left that class for the first time. I felt happy. I felt alive. And I felt hopeful. I auditioned for A Streetcar Named Desire, and somehow I ended up getting it. The scary thing was not the audition. The scary thing was getting cast. And I remember thinking about my lines, like, how in the world am I going to do a play? You've got to memorize all those lines. I don't think I would have been able to do it had I not had the director I had. And had I not had my support system that I didn't have prior to my acting class. I was actually attracted to theater because how militaristic it was. You have the director, this is their job. You have the techno director, this is their job. Know your lines, know your stuff. I have been able to rely on military training, and it has served me incredibly well. A professor told me to get up and do something, I got up and I did it. Having a big role and being put out on the stage was a lot like I had a team of people that were depending on me, and I better do my job right. And that really resonated with me. It was like going out into Iraq. There's an entire mission, and you have one role in this mission, and you had better do it right, or you're going to screw everybody else. So that pressure felt good. It felt like home. And it still does. I think it still does.